Get started. We're so happy to have you. This series is a collaboration with Travis County Natural Resources and the City of Austin Balcones Canyonlands Preserve. We co-manage this incredible 32,000 plus acre preserve that protects the habitat for multiple species in Central Texas, allows for a development process that is predictable and permanently protects the rest of that habitat so that these species can continue to thrive. We have a great speaker for you today. Dr. Colin Morrison is here and he's going to talk about Texas passion flower natural history, Texas passion vine natural history. He'll present on the natural history of seven passion vines that are native to Texas. Colin will cover descriptions of what they look like, where they can be found, and the cool interactions that they have with the insects that eat them. Colin was raised in Las Vegas, Nevada. In 2012, he received a bachelor's degree in biology at the University of Nevada, Reno. He then worked as a research assistant at the University of Nevada, followed by a fellowship with the Smithsonian Institute in Panama from 2015 to 2016. He started his PhD at the University of Texas at Austin in 2017 with Dr. Larry Gilbert and just completed his doctorate this April. Congratulations. His PhD focuses on passion vines, as well as the ecology of invasive insects and plants in Texas. He's broadly interested in answering questions about how plant chemistry, natural enemies, and natural resources combine to determine what herbivorous insects eat different plant species and how these associations contribute to biodiversity. After the presentation, Jeremy Hull of Travis County will manage the Q&A session. So feel free to put all the questions that you might have in the Q&A box, not in the chat. If you'll look for the little Q&A box, we'll be sure to get to your question if time allows. There will be a recording of the webinar posted on Facebook and on our YouTube channel as well. And on that note, I'll stop sharing my screen and turn it over to Colin. Thanks, Colin.
Thank you, Kate, for that lovely introduction. All right, happy Friday, folks. I'm really pleased to be joining you today from Kenya, where I am here doing some research as a new postdoctoral research associate with the Brackenridge Field Lab at UT Austin. Just brief context, we're researching invasive species here that are present in Texas. We study them here in Kenya so that we can try to figure out how to leverage their biology in our home. But that's not what I'm going to be talking about today. Today, I'm going to share with you the natural history of Texas passion vines and a little bit about their specialist insect herbivores. So I was really fortunate to be able to learn a lot about the seven species of passion vines that make their home in Texas during my PhD, where I studied the ecology of passion vines and the things that eat them and why don't they eat all of them. So start with a brief outline of what we're gonna go through today. I'm gonna try to keep the talk to about half an hour to leave plenty of time for questions. So we'll start with a little introduction to the system of passion vines and their animal associates. And then I'm gonna go through and talk about the seven species of passion vines that are in Texas and talk about where they're found, what they look like, and some interesting anecdotes about them. And then I'll wrap up the talk today with a discussion of the specialist insect herbivores that eat passion vines. We'll begin with an introduction. Passion vines number about 500 species or so, distributed around the world, but primarily in the neotropics, primarily throughout Central America, South America. But their whole distribution ranges from fairly high up in North America all the way down into the temperate regions of South America. And what you might be able to gain from just looking at a few select examples of passion vines in this photo here is that they have a ton of diversity in a number of ways. They're morphologically diverse. They have a number of different associations with different natural enemies like ants that protect them in exchange for other benefits. Passion vines are also really interesting as far as their chemistry. They have many different chemical compounds. A really well-known one is cyanide, that makes them unpalatable to most animals, whether that's a deer or an insect. And some of the insects that eat those passion vines are what inspired me to research them for my PhD studies. I'll give you a couple examples of those. Here we have longwing butterfly caterpillars. Longwing butterfly caterpillars are very co-evolved to eat passion vines. They only eat passion vines. And the most striking thing about them is that when you look at these caterpillars here and the adults, butterflies that come from them, is that they're all really brightly colored and conspicuous. And the reason that they advertise their conspicuousness like this is because they're able to take cyanide that's present in the tissues of the passion vines, and they incorporate that cyanide into their own bodies so that they become toxic to their own natural enemies, their own predators. So this is one group that we're going to talk about that eats passion vines. The other group of insects that only eat passion vines are beetles. These are leaf beetles in the species-rich family called the Chrysomelidae, the leaf beetles. And within the Chrysomelidae, these beetles are in a tribe, a taxonomic tribe called the flea beetles. And they're called flea beetles because they have really strong hind legs, where if they're threatened, they are able to jump away very quickly from a threat. Flea beetles are very diverse. There's thousands of species, and there's a group of them that also only eat passion vines. And one thing I figured out during my PhD studies is that they also are able to take the cyanide from their plants, incorporate it into their own bodies so that they can use the plant defenses to make themselves toxic. And that's reflected in the fact that they are also very conspicuous, brightly colored, advertising their toxicity to their natural enemies. Just give you a little bit of context about why I was interested in studying these interesting phenomena from a community ecology perspective. This graph is a food web where each line shows the caterpillar species represented by their butterfly adults on top of the graph and all of the different paths they eat in one particular region in Costa Rica. What you can see from this graph is that there are a lot of different passion vines and a lot of different caterpillars that eat them. Some of these caterpillars are only eating a few of the passion vines that are available in this community, and others that have many lines going to different plants are eating a number of them in their communities. So I was interested in trying to understand, why are some of them so picky and others are eating the whole salad of passion vines that are available in these landscapes? And the types of things that I studied and found some answers to during my PhD revolve around this conceptual framework that we see here on the right of the slide, where we have species interactions like caterpillars that eat plants that are mediated by the traits of the plants. The plants are, from the perspective of the insects, the plants are what they taste like. The plants are their chemicals. And the chemicals in these plants are generally very full of cyanide, but it's not just the same cyanide. There's different cyanides in these plants that allow them to be eaten by different species. And below that level, it all ultimately depends on what nutrients are available in the soil. I just wanted to give you all a background about that to give a little bit of context from the perspective that inspired me to go into studying these passion vines. But today, we're not going to be talking about mechanisms and processes. We're going to focus on the natural history of the passion vines in Texas and give a little bit of ideas about what we can do to preserve them at Balcones and elsewhere around our state and our nation. So, let's go through the seven species that we have in Texas. But first, what is a passion vine or a passion flower? What are the morphological parts of a passion vine? This example is easy to exemplify because it's a big flower. This is Passiflora cerulea. It's probably the most commonly planted passion vine around Texas. It is not native. It is from South America. But interestingly, it's from temperate latitudes in South America that are at the same relative latitude as Texas, basically. So this plant is able to do really well. But all that aside, it's a good example. So we see that on this flower, we have the stigma is, I don't have the pointer here. but you can see where it's pointing to. The stigma is positioned above the ovaries of the plants, and the anthers that have the pollen are below them. So if a pollinator has to come in here to get the pollen, it has to make contact with both of these things if pollination is going to occur. Below the ovary and the anthers is the operculum, the bottom of the reproductive organ of the plant. It's surrounded by these beautiful filaments, these blue and white filaments that give passion vines a lot of their really charismatic appeal. Now, the vine part of the passion vine is like so. This is Passiflora cerulea again, where we have tendrils. All passion vines have tendrils, whether they are a vine, a woody vine, also known as a liana, or a small tree. There's some small trees of passion vines in the tropics. They all have tendrils that are opposite the leaf. This is an important characteristic. Also, all passion vines have a bract. The bract is actually what taxonomists rely upon to distinguish different passion vine species in addition to their flowers. And then, of course, we have the leaves and a developing flower bud here. Okay. I'm highlighting the species that are present at Balcones Canyon Preserve here in the green next to the name. And first up, we have Passiflora affinis, known as the bracted passion vine. This passion vine is a hill country endemic, where you only find this growing around karst limestone deposits that have to be fairly close to a water source. So the place to look for these is on rocky outcrops that are close to a spring, close to a river, and they'll be coming out of cracks in the limestone. And the way that I like to differentiate this passion vine from some others that we'll see later is that the leaves have these deep lobes in them that look more like a glove. There's another one that we're going to talk about later that looks like a mitten. And this passion vine has extra floral nectaries that attract ants to it, and they look like little dots, little yellow dots on the bottom of the leaf. And the flowers are nice cream-colored yellow flower, small, fairly inconspicuous, but very pretty. Next up, we have one of my favorite-looking passion vines in Central Texas. It's Passiflora tenua loba, known as the birdwing passion vine, because it has this really long morphology of the leaf that is looks kind of like a birdwing or a batwing. These are also fairly well-restricted to Central Texas, but you also find these going out towards the west, too. And similar to Passiflora affinis, the bracted passion vine, they'll grow around karst limestone through the cracks in the walls, close to a water source, but not necessarily. Like you see this purplish variety here in the middle. This is just growing out of some dirt in the middle of a fairly degraded ranch in South Texas, for example. One of the things that I think is so cool about this passion vine is that it's a really good mimic of other plant species that are growing in its habitat. So if you look to the bottom left of this slide here, you see there's the Passiflora affinis here in the middle, and it's growing around Agarita. When you look at this slide, it's fairly easy to tell the passion vine leaves from the Agarita, but when you're just walking around in the hill country, it's really hard to tell the difference. And what's interesting about this is that this particular one has a morphology that's really similar to the Agarita, but if you're in an area with a lot of greenbrier, smilax, the morphology tends to really match the greenbrier. For an even more extreme example of this that I don't have a photo of, unfortunately, but you can imagine you're in brush country in South Texas with a lot of grassland. There's Passiflora affinis growing out of the brush savanna that looks just like the grass. So this species, the hypothesis is that its local leaf morphology matches what the majority of the plants in that ecosystem look like. And this could be to avoid detection by its herbivores, by blending and looking like everything else. And one more thing I want to point out on this slide is this top right here. There's this aluminum foil covered glass vial with a bunch of shoots of Passiflora tenua loba sticking out of it. Passion vines are really easy to cull from cuttings if you're interested in growing for yourself. And the reason that I've put this aluminum foil around the bottle, there's just a little bit of water in the bottom of that. And what happens is it makes it dark. So the vines think that they're underground and they start putting out roots in this situation. So this is a great way to grow passion vines. Okay. Next up, we have Passiflora suberosa. This is known as corky stem passion vine. And the corky stem is the character that really defines the species. You see in this middle picture, top left of the map, is that a mature plant that is maybe 2 or 3 more years old develops this cork all around the stem. Cork, the chemical name for cork is suberin, like Passiflora suberosa. That same cork that's harvested from trees for wine corks and such. So I think that's just kind of cool, is that this cork, it provides a nice sort of medium to keep the vine underneath it from drying out in rough conditions. And this species is not found in balcones. This is only found naturally in deep South Texas, Rio Grande Valley, and distributed throughout Mexico, making it south about as far as Guatemala or Honduras. You'll also see on the map that there's a bunch of observations of it in Florida, but it's not entirely clear if it's actually native in Florida, but regardless, it's there. Has a nice green and yellow flower, fairly small, but very pretty when these come out. And these flowers mature into these little green fruits here. And I chose to put this picture in here because it shows an interesting phenomena with the passion vines, that when the fruits are green, like the leaves, they're full of cyanide. They are really toxic, and it's because the seeds are not ready to be dispersed yet. They're not mature yet. But once the seeds are mature, they're ready to be dispersed. The fruit in a matter of days changes to this purple color, and this sends a signal to dispersers of the fruit, like birds, that it's ready to be eaten. Go for it, eat me, and then disperse my seeds, please. This is what we call an honest signal in biology, where there is a physiological change in the structure that confers a benefit to both the seed disperser that wants a meal and the plant because it gets to spread. Next up here, we have Passiflora fetida, known as the stinking passion vine. You'll see in the map here on the bottom right that this has a very wide natural distribution from South Texas. The furthest north natural populations of this are probably Mathis, Texas, Corpus Christi area. I find this growing grasslands and brush country in South Texas quite commonly, but it's very well distributed all the way down into Ecuador and perhaps even northern Peru and throughout the Caribbean. It also has a number of different names, a number of really cool names, especially in Spanish, like Corona de Cristo. And the Corona de Cristo name comes from the fact that as the fruit starts to mature, these bracts that you can see really nicely in this top right photo here cover the fruit until it's ready to be dispersed. Similar to the green to purple example that I just showed, red, like this picture in the center here. And the bracts begin to move away from the plant to expose it to a bird or a reptile that might come along and eat it. These red fruits here are really tasty. And I want to highlight that because I'd recommend that you try it if it's at this point. But I also want to caution a lot too, is that you don't want to mess around with cyanide. It's really toxic. So you want to make sure that you consult online resources before deciding if you're going to taste the natural products of these things. But if it's this red, Passiflora fetida is good to eat. The other species, I will not recommend that because I don't know. Next up, we have Passiflora lutea, which is common at balcones as well as the entire southeast of the United States. This is probably the most abundant, not probably, this is definitely the most abundant, numerically abundant passion vine in the United States. This is called yellow passion vine, and a good way to tell it is when it's flowering, is it has 2 yellow flowers. This is the only species of the 7 that I'm showing today that will always have 2 flowers at the same time. Further south into the tropics, there's a number of species in this clade that always have 2 flowers coming out from the bract where the petiole and the tendril separate. And you also might remember that I said the Passiflora affinis, the bracted passion vine, the first one that I showed, the leaf looks more like a glove. Yeah, the leaf look. What I'm trying to get out here is that the difference is that there's gloves and there's mittens. So gloves, your fingers can be seen. So the Passiflora affinis, the first one, looks more like a glove with lobes that go into your fingers. And the Passiflora lutea looks more like a mitten. Another big difference between Passiflora lutea and Passiflora affinis is that Passiflora lutea is the only species in Texas that does not have extrafloral nectaries. And this is kind of interesting. These extrafloral nectaries attract the ants, which do a good service to the plant by defending it from herbivores in exchange for the nectar. And what hypothesis I have about this plant is that from measurements I've taken, is that the amount of cyanide in the leaves of Passiflora lutea is higher than any of the other species that we have in Texas. And it seems like a good hypothesis from this is that there's an ecological trade-off here. The nectar is full of nitrogen and amino acids to the ants. It doesn't have nectar. So perhaps some of that nitrogen is being given towards nitrogen-based cyanide compounds instead. Anyway, this species has another really interesting morphological phenomena that I'd like to point out. In this picture that I'm left here with my hand in the photo, is you see these white lines running down the veins of these leaves here. This is called variegation. And the variegation is where there's spots in the leaves where there's no green chlorophyll being expressed. So therefore it's white. The hypothesis behind why a plant might express variegation is that it helps it blend in a little bit more with its background. Because the plant has selective pressure to not have herbivores like butterflies and beetles lay their eggs on it to eat it. So if it's a little bit harder to find because it's a little more camouflaged into the background because of this white mottled background, that might be a benefit of this. There's a lot of variation in this. So there's you can see in the pictures here, many of these have no variation. There's some that have some degree of it. And this is probably the most common species, again, like I said, that you'll find in Central Texas or about Paradise. Next, we have Passiflora incarnata, or Maypop, or the purple passion vine. This passion vine has the most showy flower in the United States. Big, big lavender to purple flower, about as big as your fist, maybe even a little bit bigger. It's really beautiful. This species has a little bit of importance historically because it was the first species of Passiflora, passion vines, that Carl Linnaeus, the founder of the hierarchical system of taxonomy that we still use today, this was the first species that he described in the genus, which means that this is the type species for the entire genus of passion vines. So the characters that Carl Linnaeus described from the species, like the tendrils and the bracts, the floral morphology, those were the characters that were then used to define all of the other species of passion vines that were subsequently described by other folks. The Maypop is also very, very widely distributed in the United States, making it as far north as Indiana, Illinois, Ohio. It's got, kind of a northern limit freeze tolerance. And this species is really highly attended by ants. It has nectaries in not just one position, but two. Many of the passion vines have nectaries along the petiole only, but this species has nectaries on the petiole, but also along the rims of the leaf. So there's tons of ants that defend this leaf against herbivores. So this is a really challenging place for an egg to be laid. The ants will take care of that egg, get rid of it really quickly, or for a young caterpillar. And kind of opposite to the yellow passion vine story that I said earlier, where it does not have nectaries, but it has really high cyanide, this species is the opposite. It has tons of ants. So presumably a lot of that nitrogen towards the amino acids is defending it again with respect to the ants, but it has really, really low levels of cyanide in the leaves. So this seems like maybe a counterexample to the ecological trade-off. The last species in Texas that I'm going to showcase today is probably the least well known. This is Passiflora philippes with a slender passion vine. It is only found in the Rio Grande Valley. And as far as I know, it's only found at the Sable Palm Sanctuary in Brownsville. And that's because this species is a specialist for subtropical dry forests that used to be quite common in that area, as well as in Tamaulipas, Mexico, but have largely been cleared for agricultural purposes. And with the ecosystem went the plants, but there's still some out there. This species is a close relative of Passiflora lutea, and it has, you know, sort of that mitten-shaped leaf again, but they're quite a bit smaller. These are small leaves, they're very thin, and very thin vines as well. But as white flowers, it's the only species of these seven that have white or maybe a little bit cream-colored flowers of all of them. And when it goes to flower, there you can see that in this kind of middle picture here on the middle bottom. There'll be tons of flowers on this thing. It produces a lot of seeds. And I get volunteers of this growing like crazy from the few collections that I've made that we have at the Brackenridge Field Laboratory. You see here on the map that there's a number of other observations that have been made in other areas of Mexico, but these are somewhat questionable. It might be that these are in similar areas of tropical dry forests that still exist between Chiapas, Sinaloa, Tamaulipas, but it's likely that these are actually other species that have been misidentified. Regardless, it's the most rare passion vine species in the political boundaries of the United States. Okay, we're gonna wrap up today with talking about some of the specialist insects that eat passion vines in Texas, starting with the caterpillars and butterflies. I find it remarkable that, you know, I go to the supermarket and, you know, next to the Tic Tacs at the checkout aisle, there's all the great field guides. And of the butterflies field guide that you find there, a passion vine long-winged butterfly is on the cover. I think that's just fantastic. And the species that's on the cover is the zebra longwing. In these next slides, in the top right here, is these lovely drawings of the passion vines, just to give you an idea of the diet breadth of these species, the number of different passion vine species that they do consume in Texas. So first up here, we have Heliconius charthonia, the zebra longwing. This is a really cool species that's been studied like crazy by myself and a number of my former lab mates at the University of Texas. It exists it's always found in the Rio Grande Valley. It has this really interesting metapopulation dynamic situation. Metapopulations is where you have all these different populations that interact to expand their ranges when conditions are correct. And when conditions are correct, precipitation, et cetera, they will make their way as far as central Texas, and they can be found at a number of different preserves, including Balcones around Travis County. This species is the only Heliconius in the world out of dozens of them that has this zebra pattern. And it just has a big love in my heart because it's the first one that I really studied really extensively. Next up, we have the most familiar long-winged butterfly to most of us, which is the Agralis vanilli, the Gulf fritillary. Gulf fritillary is one of the most, I don't say generalist, but a little bit of a confusing term. It eats more passion vine species than probably any other of the long-winged butterflies. And if you're a gardener that has passion vines in your yard, you might have some interesting opinions about the species, but it is most definitely a native species that eats passion vines. And the caterpillars are really beautiful looking with these spiky red warning colorations. Like I said earlier, all of these caterpillars are sequestering cyanide. They're toxic. And this is a good example of a situation that some of us might have seen and maybe not have understood, like myself until recently, where you get these caterpillars that just look like these gloppy messes that are hanging on to the vines. What's happened to this caterpillar is that it's become infected with a virus called nucleopolyhydrosis virus, or NPV. This is a really devastating virus for your local long-winged butterflies. And it also spreads to other species of moths and butterflies as well, where this caterpillar has grabbed on with its legs and its rigor mortis, and it's going to burst open and have all these spores of this NPV virus fall out all over the plant. This became really clear to me during COVID when I brought a lot of my plant species for my research back to my house to study. And all of a sudden, this virus just overtook all my plants. And I was like, what do I do? How do we deal with this? And a good, good holistic technique, if you have the virus killing all your caterpillars, is to take your plants, put them out in the sun, because UV radiation from the sun is a really effective killer of virus. Just a little extension note there. Another great species that makes its way into Central Texas sometimes is Dryas julia, or Julia heliconia. This species is very abundant, very widespread from temperate South America and Uruguay and Argentina, all the way into Central Texas. And if you're lucky enough to see this butterfly, it means that, similar to the zebra longwing, that the metapopulation dynamics, where it's always present down in the valley, are such that it is able to make its way up into Central Texas. And these are beautiful caterpillars, these white, gray, black model caterpillars that turn into these pure orange adults. It also eats many of the available species of passion vines that it will find in Texas across its range. And lastly, one of my favorites is the variegated fritillary, Euptoyeta claudia. Euptoyeta claudia is mostly a passion vine specialist. It prefers to eat passion vines if they're available, but it also eats violets. You can see up here in the top right, which is why its distribution is much, much greater than the distribution of the passion vines that we've seen here. Because up north here in the Dakotas and even into Canada, it has an alternative host plant that it can eat. This is another, it also sequesters cyanide, which is interesting because it eats more than just passion vines, but it still has the ability to take some cyanide on. And these white, black, red caterpillars, these nice orange butterflies that are fairly common. And if you see this around, this means that the habitat is in pretty good shape. Okay. Last group of insects that I want to cover here are the passion vine leaf beetles. I have a little bit of chip of my shoulder about these passion vine leaf beetles because in many ways they are doing the same role ecologically as the caterpillars are. They only eat passion vines, they sequester cyanide from their plants, become toxic, and are a control on the diversity of the plants. But for whatever reasons, they haven't been studied that much. So I've done a little bit of work on that, but if you're looking for a project in grad school or know someone that is, or just want to do some hobby science towards understanding these beetles more, please reach out to me and I can give you some great ideas because I don't really have time to study them anymore. First one is the passion vine leaf beetle that's most common in Central Texas as well as throughout the Southeast United States. And this is Dysonica discoidea. This eats maypop, Passiflora affinis, bractopassion vine, and yellow passion vine. And these are these fantastic bright red colored caterpillars, or, you know, grubs, because they're beetles. The eggs, like you can see up here in the top right, are also bright red. One discovery I made that's yet to be published is that these eggs are full of cyanide. So the caterpillars and the adults are able to get the cyanide from their plants, and then the mothers are able to endow their eggs with cyanide so that they are protected from their predators as well. It's not rare, but it's patchy distribution, where I might do a survey of all the Passiflora luteas or Passiflora incarnatas in Central Texas and not find them on 90% of the plants, but on the 10% that I do find them, they're always there year after year. So if you find these things, go back the next year and you'll see a familiar friend. Finally, relative of Discoidea is Dysonica stenostica. This is the yellow-striped passion vine beetle, and this is only found in the Rio Grande Valley, perhaps up in Corpus Christi as well, and it has a little bit more narrow diet breadth than Discoidea, where in the United States, the only species that it's eating is the corky stem passion vine, Passiflora subarosa. Like the red passion vine beetle, Discoidea, it is highly warning-colored. It sequesters a ton of cyanide from its host plants, and they're a great system to study for the ecology of host plant herbivore interactions in this system. All right, and with that, I just want to acknowledge some folks here that were inspirational collaborators and friends in my journey to study the passion vines, learn about them. Got my advisor, Dr. Larry Gilbert, who's advised over 45 students at UT Austin. I'm probably going to be his last student. I'm privileged for that. Below him is John Smiley, who is one of the first students of Larry Gilbert, who actually was the guy that got me into studying passion vines. And then I've got research assistants, collaborators, the butterflies themselves. And I would highly recommend that you guys reach out to me if you have any questions about passion vines in your homes, in the preserves. And just say to end that if you see these passion vines, any of these in an environment, it is a good sign that environment is in good shape, that it's not disturbed, it's not being ridden with invasive species. So seeing passion vines is a nice indication that that environment is in pretty good shape. And with that, love to chat with y'all and take your questions.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Colin. That was a fantastic presentation. I learned a lot. That was just great. Before we get into questions, I want to say that Kate's going to be posting some links into the chat for everyone if they want to go and learn some more about the VCP and an active map and things like that, and maybe some volunteer activities that we have going on. Be sure and check those out. While we're going through Q&A, if more questions pop into your head, feel free to throw them in the Q&A box and we'll get to as many of them as we can. Before I get into the questions that were asked, I had one question. Is typically, when do most of these, and it probably varies by species, but what is the flowering period for most of these passion vines? Are they kind of late summer or?
It's really variable with passion vines. I would say that late summer is your best generalization of when they're going to be flowering, set fruit by maybe September or so. Because like a lot of the species in the whole country or in, you know, throughout the state, they're gonna do best in germination if they have a nice winter period for scarification, kind of get mixed in with the soil.
Perfect. Okay. First question here was: Are your range maps that you're using from iNaturalist?
They are.
Excellent. Is there a difference in flower size between lutea and aphanus?
No, not really. They're very similar, but the big difference is that lutea is going to have two flowers 95% of the time, and aphanus will have two flowers maybe 5% of the time. So if you have two flowers, lutea, one flower, aphanus. But the other good characteristic, again, the glove and mittens comparison, and Passiflora aphanus has nectaries, look like little yellow dots when viewing the leaf from below, and lutea does not have nectaries. It's just a straight green leaf.
Perfect. We had two questions about this, so I'm gonna ask them at the same time here. The first one was, since the ants will eat eggs on the leaves, will the ants also attack the caterpillars? And then a follow-up was that is just, can you talk more, a little bit more about the relationships between the ants and the passion vines?
Yeah. So to the first question, yes, the ants will attack the caterpillars, and it is the strongest source of mortality on the heliconius. Just the heliconius. We'll get to this in a second. That there's been some studies done on this where conservative estimate is that 70% of caterpillars are killed by the ants before they reach their third instar, which is about the middle of their caterpillar development. And the reason that it stops at about third instar is that the caterpillars are fairly big, a little bit more difficult for the ants to handle. And by that point, they've sequestered enough cyanide that it's a risk for the ants to deal with them at that point. And then, yeah, just to expand upon the ants, the extrafloral nectaries of the passion vines are full of two critical ingredients for the ants. They're full of carbohydrates, sugars. And this is a variety of different sugars, sucrose, glucose, fructose in rare situations, but sometimes, and amino acids that are predictable. As long as the plant is not super water stressed, it's going to be continually producing this nectar. So the ants have a strong incentive to guard that nectar in the same way that ants guard, you know, aphids or whiteflies or some different hemipterans. And the ants don't actually, they're not eating the caterpillars. As far as we know, they're generally just killing them. Like they'll chop it up a bit, kind of rough it up, take it to the edge of the leaf and drop it off, presumably because of the cyanide. Globally, the 500 or so described passion vine species, I reckon that 90% of them have extrafloronectaries. Not having them seems to be the exception. And of the ones that I've assayed, those 10% that don't have the extrafloronectaries tend to have really high cyanide concentrations. So it's perhaps a mechanism to sort of make up for that fact that the ants aren't defending them.
And that's interesting interactions there. I love that. So next one here, are any of the passion vines found in Texas considered invasive?
Of these seven that I spoke about, no. There's a number of introduced species in Texas, and including the Passiflora cerulea that I use as the example to describe the morphology of the plants. But I wouldn't call it invasive. It's certainly not native, but I don't see any evidence for it really escaping the areas where it's planted and establishing in a way that we could consider it invasive, such that it's a problem to people as far as economic problem or health problem or cultural issue. Trying to break my brain a little more. No, I don't think that there's any other passion vine species that we could really consider invasive. If you ask that question in Florida, that might be a different situation. Like you might have seen in some of those range maps that a number of the species like Fetida and Subarosa are observed often in Florida, and it's hard to imagine how they would have dispersed there. It's possible, but in that system, they do escape the areas where they're planted, much more common. And you'd have to ask folks there if they consider them invasive or not.
So does the distribution of these seven species go no further than West Texas?
Yes. The furthest west of these species that's known would be batwing, birdwing passion vine in Texas, or Passiflora tenuloba. Yeah, it does not seem to go any further than, maybe the Pecos River. There are three species of passion vines that grow in Arizona and New Mexico that are really, really cool species that are extremely rare. There's Passiflora. There's three of them basically that are all Sonoran Desert endemics. One of them, called Passiflora Mexicana, might make it into drainages, riparian areas in far west Texas in the Big Bend area. And I would highly recommend that people go get into those areas, in Big Bend Ranch especially, not very observed, and see if they find them in some of those areas, because the habitat would work. But yes, as far as I know, none of these species really make it any further than the Pecos River. Wild.
Excellent. We have one last question here, and then we'll see if any other pop up in the time being. But the next one is really interesting. Isn't there a specialized bee associated with Passiflora lutea feed that may feed only on its pollen?
Yeah, that is a great question. I considered throwing in a slide about this at the end. It's an andrenid bee, I believe, which is like a relative of the leafcutter bees. It's a solitary bee, nests in the ground. And yes, as far as we know, it only feeds on the pollen of Passiflora lutea. that's like the pollination situation with passion vines is pretty unstudied, that's for sure. Presumably because floral botanists, pollination ecologists have looked at the passion vines, and there's not the position of the stigmas relative to the anthers. It doesn't suggest that there's any highly co-evolved situations going on with like fitting into that flower, because it's all just kind of open. But it's interesting to me that bee, as far as we know, only gets pollen from lutea. And this observation has been confirmed like across a number of places, from Indiana, Maryland, Florida, Texas. It seems to be the case across its entire range. So that is the only example I know of a specialized pollinator on bees, but I would reckon that there is more. It's just something that folks haven't looked into yet. So I'd recommend that you do.
Excellent. And then Lynn posted in the Q&A, I believe that might be the species name for it, Anthemergus passiflorae. might be that specific bee. And then it piqued both of them, I think, because they spend a lot of time in Big Bend, but they asked then, what was that species again that you wanted to look for in the Trans-Pecos?
Yeah, it's called Passiflora mexicana. It kind of, you see these zebra long wings on the right of the slide here? It has that same sort of flora morphology where there's two big lobes of the leaf, bilaterally symmetrical. It's a dark green color. It has beautiful purple pink flowers. And that'd be the one to look for in the Trans-Pecos region. It wouldn't surprise me if it's there. It's known to make it like about, it makes it about halfway through New Mexico going east. No. So it's hard to imagine that there's some barrier that would really stop it from going further, because the Toronto Desert environment is fairly similar, and there is drainages that would link up between those areas, and it's getting dispersed by birds. So yeah, please let me know if you find it there. That would be really cool, because it's a really fun quest to go look for these Southwest Desert passion vine species.
Excellent. That looks like the last of our questions here. We've had several comments in here about, this one's great. So I love the genus. Thank you for sharing your knowledge and, they dare say, your passion for these plants. So you got to love a good pun. But several others that are saying they would love to hear about your work in Kenya. And I know you're doing that associated with the Brackenridge Field Lab. So do you guys often have talks about things that you all have going on there?
Outside of the academic space, no. Not never, but since I've been involved, like as a grad student, I participated in Science Under the Stars and some other public facing events in this way, but I don't know if we've really done a very good job in public talks. I'll get more into what we're doing here in a second, but we've been fortunate enough to get the College of Natural Science Communications to distribute press releases about the work. So you might have seen some of the things that we've been doing with invasive grasses and the invasive moth that's threatening our prickly pear cactus through the news, amongst other places. But in Kenya, what we're doing is some of the invasive grass species that are really problematic in South Texas, amongst other regions, are native here in the kind of brush country, savanna equivalent in Kenya. So we come over here to study the biology and the interactions with arthropods, insect herbivores, in the grass's native environment to see if we can understand what are the constraints from natural enemies or competition with other plants that are no longer an issue for these grasses in Texas, for example. And the reason that we do that is it's twofold. One, it's interesting, for the advancing fundamentals of ecology, but it shows weaknesses perhaps for the plants that we can try to leverage in an integrated pest management control program to try to manage them towards a goal that is basically naturalizing them such that they don't dominate ecosystems, especially without people's consent.
Awesome. Yeah, that sounds really interesting. Maybe you could eventually they could have a series just like ours and have these webinars about what you guys are doing, because it's all really interesting stuff.
I'd love to come back and chat about that another time too, if the opportunity presents itself.
Awesome. Well, again, thank you so much for joining us today. That wraps up all of our questions, so we're going to go ahead and cut it off here. But again, Colin, thank you so much. Everyone, we are recording this, and it will be a resource for the future. And I think it'll be a great resource. So thank you for joining us today.
Thanks, Colin.
Thanks for your attention.